Praise the Lord, everybody.
Yes,
before we turn the slide, I wanted to bring our attention actually to Romans 14 and 9. Yeah. This is from the Amplified Bible. It says, "So let us then definitely aim for and eagerly pursue what makes for harmony and for mutual upbuilding, edification, and development of one another."
Amen.
And so I just wanted to,
Amen.
While we're worshiping the Lord tonight, let's be praying and thinking about the body of Christ,
yes.
Thinking about our brothers and sisters, those who are here, those who are not here. There are things just going on in people's lives right now, and we all need Jesus.
Amen.
Right now.
Right.
I know we need him each and every day, but to make it through the challenges and the storms that are happening right now, we really need to allow Jesus to step in and take control of our hearts and our minds. You know, just of every situation. So if we can be lifting up the body of Christ, you might not know the circumstance. The Lord might lay something or someone on your heart, not just now, but over the next couple weeks. But
right.
Let's be in prayer for our brothers and sisters.
Amen.
Be in prayer for one another, not just our church, but the whole body of Christ. Amen.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
The glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Let it rise.
Joy of the King.
Blessed be your your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though this pain is the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn that to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name.
Second verse of that, because it's all easy to praise the Lord when everything's going right and everything's going your way, but it's when you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death that that's when it's best to say blessed be your name. But it's not always easy, and that's what we have to get used to, is that in the midst of the adversity, because he gives and takes away, and he doesn't do anything without purpose. And he doesn't do anything without our best interest at heart. It might not feel good at that time, but he has a purpose. And if we are trusting in him, we will see the end of what he's working. Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint. You won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint. You won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint. You won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord our God. You reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are. Defender of
sometimes it's good to be in a weak place, because that's when he can come in and defend you.
Amen.
When we're weak, that's when he's the strongest. And I love the fact that he's everlasting, because I can go to bed at night knowing that he's still going. I can take a break knowing that God is working all the time, nonstop. And I have to tell myself that regularly. Put it aside, put it away, give it to God.
Amen.
Because it's not for me to handle. He's going to handle it.
Amen.
And I trust him. Amen.
Amen.
There is a truth that's older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the dark. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. In the night, there is a voice that calms the storm that rages. He is Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire. Like a light. Jesus. There is a name I call in times of trouble. There is a song that comforts in the night. There is a voice that calms the storm that rages. Truth that's older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born of our salvation. He's Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, you're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? All the world can come to him and have their sins removed. Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? All the world can come to him to have their sins removed. Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful? Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful? Son of God and one of us, the lover of my soul. Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful? Eternal. Isn't the name of Jesus powerful? Chains are broken when it's spoken, every knee must bow. Isn't the name of Jesus powerful? Isn't the name of Jesus powerful? Isn't the name of Jesus powerful? Chains are broken when it's spoken, and every knee must bow. Isn't the name of Jesus powerful? Eternal King, you will reign forever, and we will sing the glory. All we need.
Jehovah Jireh, you are more than enough, Lord God. You are all that we need. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'll give him a little more praise. He's worthy of it. Lord Jesus, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. I praise you, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord, for your presence. We thank you, Lord God. We thank you for your spirit and your word, Lord God. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, we thank you, Lord. You are worthy. Yes, Lord God. You are worthy. You are worthy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. We're dismissing, amen, the singers and the musicians. Thank you. Amen. You may be seated here tonight. I'm going to ask Brother Stephen to help us receive an offering here. And it's good to see everybody here tonight. Amen. Praise God.
Lord God. I want to thank
yes,
you for this
Lord.
Time in your presence, Lord, that we might seek you and learn of you. Just bring these tithes and these offerings to your storehouse, O Lord. Pray that you'd bless it and sanctify it, that this gospel message might be spread. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Again, camp is coming up, so if you're planning on being there on the August 14th through 18th week, and planning on being there for lunches at the church on the 14th, 15th, and or the 15th, 16th, and 17th, then please fill out one of those forms back on the table and put it in that manila folder back there so we know how to plan for food. Amen. Praise God. Sister Tremaine was talking about the need to pray. And some of you know the Jireys and Sister Melissa Jirey, and they had a big loss in their family today and in their church. And so just pray for them and for wisdom. It was unexpected. And actually the person that passed away, I know pretty well myself. Amen. So it was kind of a shock what happened. And so just pray. We don't understand it. But the thing we do know is, things are in God's hands, and as long as you don't let go and I don't let go of God's hands, everything is going to be okay. Remember, Jesus said, No man can pluck you out of my hand. Now, I can jump out of God's hand. I can walk out of God's hand. But once I'm in his hand, if I decide I want to stay there, no man can take me out. No spirit can take me out. So it's, do I want to be in his hand or do I want to be in my own hand? Amen. So let's just pray for them right now. Lord God, we're asking you, Lord, to help the Jari's church, Lord, Melissa Jari, her family, Brother Jari, Lord, the church there, Lord God. You know the circumstances. You're Lord of all. You're able to turn things that the enemy means for bad into good. You're able to make all things work together for good to them that love you and are called according to your purpose, Lord. We're asking you, Lord, to work in that, to strengthen them, Lord God, and to bring out of this circumstance great things, Lord God. We're asking you, Lord, to work miracles, Lord God, and to turn darkness into night, Lord God, or turn the night into light, Lord God, turn that darkness of night to light. And we're praising you here tonight, Lord, in your name, believing that you're greater than our circumstances. In Jesus' name, amen. So we started last week on the role of a Christian, and we talked about called to be a saint. We defined what the word Christian meant a little bit, and then we talked about called to be a saint. And just to summarize it, to be a saint really means to reflect the glory of God. Amen. Okay, because he said, be ye holy, for I am holy. Okay, be ye holy in all manner of conversation, Old King James. And that conversation means manner of living. It's not just our speech, but they understood that the way we live says something. Amen. So they said that. So tonight we're going to talk about the role of a Christian. We are sheep. Okay, we're called to be saints, but we're sheep. So we're going to read Psalm 23, very short psalm, but powerful psalm with so much depth in it. Even a lot of people that don't really go to church often know Psalm 23. Amen. And then we'll go to John 10 and 11, and then Ephesians 4 and 11. So Psalm 23 says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. What beautiful words. In the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 11, and Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. And then in the epistle to the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. Another familiar scripture to many of us. It says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. We'll read verse 12. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So we are sheep. Amen. And I don't think that I'm saying anything new, but let's just talk about it from the Bible point of view. So God's people in both the Old Testament and New Testament are often referred to as sheep. That's important to understand that. So David, who was a shepherd, thought of himself as one of God's sheep. We read Psalm 23, which he wrote. So he said, the Lord's my shepherd. So David understood that just as sheep need leading, I need leading. Just as sheep need a shepherd, men need a shepherd. David understood that. So David recognized that he needed God's guidance in his daily life, just like sheep, right? Sheep don't just get shepherded on Sunday. Do they? Amen. Or Sunday and Wednesday. So they need the shepherd every day. We as God's people need the shepherd every day. Amen? So he recognized that these are some of the things that the shepherd does. He makes me to lie down. Sometimes sheep don't know when to rest or where to rest. They may just go till they're tired and then decide to rest there, and then they'll, when they recover, they may not recover. So the shepherd knows a good place for the sheep to rest and where it's going to be safe and there's going to be sustenance for them. He leads me beside the still waters. Sheep often will not drink from running water. So the shepherd has to find a place where there's a pool of water or beat off a section from the stream to get a pool of water. And so a sheep can get thirsty and maybe be dehydrated because they don't have somebody to provide that calm, peaceful water from them. Amen. Restores my soul or my strength. The shepherd makes sure that the sheep are strong. He's not going to overdrive them. You might remember the story of Jacob when he's fleeing from Laban. And he's coming, and he comes to finally to meet Esau. And Esau wants to go with him. He says, no, we'll go at our own pace because we don't want to overdrive the cattle. So if you overdrive them a little bit, they can get sick. So we need to make sure that we understand the pace. So the shepherd understands the strength of the sheep and will restore the soul or the strength of the sheep if necessary. He may have planned to move that day, but if the sheep need a little more strength, he may wait a day in order to take care of that. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake. Again, sheep don't know the right way to go. Just as human beings, we don't know the right way to go. That's why we need the Bible. We need the Word of God. We need God's wisdom and God's authority and God's ministry in our life to help lead us and guide us in the paths of righteousness. You say, well, you know, I can figure it all out. What happens when you come to two paths of righteousness? You got to make a choice, or three paths. Now you need some guidance. They could all be good, right paths in God's eyes, but is it the one for you? Is it the path that God wants you to be on? So David recognized, just as sheep need a shepherd, I need a shepherd. We need a shepherd. Amen. So we are sheep. This is the Old Testament view that we're looking at, but both the Old Testament and the New Testament bring it out. Psalm 103, the writer of the psalm, again, now speaking from the point of Israel itself, again is saying, we're your sheep. We're the sheep of your pastor. So Psalm 103, it says, know ye not that the Lord, he is God. It is he that made us, and not we ourselves, we are his people and the sheep of his pasture. So in other words, again, the writer's trying to help us understand, he recognizes that we can't do it on our own. We're not here because we did it by ourselves. We made it this far because of the Lord. We're the sheep of his pasture. He's our creator. He's got ownership of us. Ownership. In other words, he's got a right to direct us. He's got a right to set a course for us. He's got a right to hold us back or send us forward. He is our maker. We are the sheep of his flock. Now, I don't know about you, but it feels pretty good to be under the authority of Jesus. I think Sister Tremaine was saying it, you know, or somebody was saying, you can go to sleep. When you know you're under his authority and everything's good, you can go to sleep even with a plate of problems. Because you know he's going to take care of it. You know, sometimes God lets some problems come our way, so we'll pray and ask him to take care of it so that we can learn he will take care of it. So eventually I don't have to be worrying all the time because I found out he takes care of it. Amen. Again, sheep without a shepherd, they go astray. Look at Isaiah 53 and 6. Probably a fairly familiar passage again, but it's telling us some of the characteristics of sheep. All we like sheep have gone astray. What's it saying? It's saying you put a bunch of sheep, you can put them together. If there's no shepherd, they all start wandering out wherever it seems good to them. They're not looking around. They're not talking to the other sheep. Does this look like it's good or it's okay? They're just going where their instinct or their desire is sending them. And eventually they will end up astray. This is why they have shepherds for sheep. This is why a lot of times they'll have dogs to help the shepherds or other shepherds, because they keep the sheep in the open field within a perimeter, because they know that the sheep will wander wherever if they don't have somebody to keep them in the proper area. Does that make sense? Okay, again, Zechariah 13 and 7, another scripture you've probably heard. Jesus applied it to himself near the night of the Last Supper. And it says, "Awake, O sword, against my shepherd and against the man that is my fellow, saith the Lord of hosts. Smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered." So again, sheep without a shepherd, or people without a shepherd, or saints without a shepherd, are going to drift away. That's right. And that's another reason why it's not good for even for an independent church to just be by themselves. But they should be. Because you can say, well, we're a church with a bunch of people. That church will drift if it's not in fellowship with others of like-minded faith. And so sometimes people wonder about organizations, but one of the purposes for organizations is to know them that labor among you and to have fellowship with people that you know are on the same page as the Bible. Amen? So sheep naturally wander, each one going wherever it appeals to them. They'll get separated from the flock. They become vulnerable to predators when they're separated. It's a little harder when they're all herded together for them to be attacked. And they have no natural defenses. So sheep can't run fast. They don't have sharp hooves. They don't have sharp teeth. They don't really have natural defenses. And they can't see far. They can only see about 6 feet. So when the wolf is running at them, they don't know till he's in the air flying at them. So they need a shepherd. We need a shepherd, okay? Amen. This is, the Bible's trying to help us. That's part of what the Bible's saying. In the New Testament, saints are still referred to as sheep. So Jesus said he was the good shepherd. We read that in John 10 and 9, or John 10 and 11. In John 10 and 9, he says, "I'm the door to the sheepfold." In other words, if I want to be one of his sheep, I got to go through him. I can't just come down and jump over the wall. I can't sneak into the sheepfold. Jesus said, if you don't come through the door, you're a robber or a thief. So what's he talking about? He's talking about being part of the church, really. And if I'm going to be part of the church, if I'm going to belong to the body of Christ, I've got to go through Jesus. Right? I don't go through the seminary. Okay, I don't go through the ministry shaking my hand or the church board saying, you're now part of us. I don't get there because I pay a lot of money or do a lot of money for the church, or, you know, I make a lot of sacrifice or I'm on some part of the ministry. That doesn't put me in the church. I got to get born again. I've got to follow what the Bible says. A lot of people don't actually, they go to church all their life and never get in the church. Because to be born again, I've got to die to myself. Which means I might have to give up some things that I like that are not a sin. But God wants me to get them out of my life. Amen? So we got to enter in. So if we're truly his sheep, the Bible says we'll respond to his voice. All right, we look over in John 10 and 27. A good portion of John is talking about the good shepherd and the sheep. But John 10 and 27 says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Okay, now we know Jesus isn't here physically, although he can speak audibly if he wants to because he's God. But his voice is the voice of the Spirit that we still voice. His voice is the Word of God as we read it, and God speaks it to our heart. Amen. And so if I'm really one of his, I'm going to listen. I'm going to follow him. If he says, come on over here, I'm going to try to go over there. If he says, stay there, I'm going to try to stay there. Because my sheep hear my voice. They know my voice. They hear me. Amen. So part of my understanding of how this works is a lot of times when shepherds came into a city, there was a common sheepfold area where they put all the sheep in there and they all be in there. And when they got ready to leave, the shepherd would come and he'd start to call his sheep by name. And all the sheep out of all that mass of sheep, maybe several sheepfolds, the ones that were his would know his voice and come out and follow him. So that's how the Lord speaks to the world. And those that are his sheep are going to respond to his voice. Amen? Does that make sense? Jesus is called the good shepherd, the great shepherd, and the chief shepherd. So if we look over in Hebrews 13 and 20, we look over there. Hebrews 13 and 20, it says, now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant. So Jesus there is called the great shepherd of the sheep. And in 1 Peter 5 and 4, he's also referred to as the great shepherd. He says, or the chief shepherd, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. So what's it saying to us? It's saying, if you're a Christian, if you're really one of his sheep, if you're really in the body of Christ, you're under his authority, you will respond to his voice. And again, his voice is going to speak according to the word of God. That's why we study the Bible. Okay, Jesus is not going to tell you to do something that's contrary to the Bible. You believe that? I do believe that. Absolutely, I believe that. Okay, so they can come out with some new doctrine. I go look in the Bible. Does what they're saying match the Bible? If it does, I need to do it if I'm not already doing it. If it doesn't, I don't need to worry about it. Amen? Okay, so the term great shepherd and chief shepherd also indicates that there's under shepherds. Right? Chief and great means it's the chief shepherd among many shepherds. So that means there's going to be shepherds underneath Jesus. This is where the ministry comes in. We are under shepherds. Okay? So a large flock would have a chief shepherd with other shepherds under his authority. The bigger it is, the more he needs, you know, to help take care of that. So New Testament saints are still referred to as sheep. As Jesus passed on the responsibility of shepherding to the apostles. Look at John 21, 15. So John 21, 15, so when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love you. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith again to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said it unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep. Now, I recognize that he's only addressing Peter there, but the Lord knows the church is going to grow worldwide. And it's not logical that he's expecting Peter to be the only shepherd over all the flock. So this same concept is applied to other apostles and elders, and it probably he's addressing Simon because Simon probably feels like I can't do anything for the Lord because I denied him three times. And so the Lord is trying to reassure him before he leaves the scene physically, Simon, you're still called to be a shepherd. Amen. So the early church, they assigned shepherds to congregations. And just a couple scriptures, because we could look at a lot of scriptures under there. But Acts 14 and 23, we see that after Paul had gone through and established a number of churches, he backtracked through them. And it says here, and when they had ordained them elders in every church and had prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord on whom they believed. So even though Paul is the founder, along with Timothy and Barnabas or maybe Silas that are involved in there, he still assigns shepherds there, elders there, to oversee the flock. And again, it's logical. If there's a number of elders, there's going to be a chief elder because somebody often has to make the final decision. Okay, it's just logical that it works that way. Again, in Philippians 1 and 1, Philippians 1 and 1, Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus which are at Philippi, with the bishops and the deacons. So, again, already there's bishops and deacons that they have there. Why? Because there's a flock. We are sheep. We need to be shepherded. Peter described lost people as sheep without a shepherd. So you look over in 1 Peter 2 and 25. So he's talking about all those that are in the church, but he's referring to them before they came to the Lord. He says, For ye were as sheep going astray, but now are returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your soul. So Jesus wants to be the shepherd of all men and women, right? He wants to be the shepherd for everyone. He wants to be the bishop of our soul. But before we come to God, when we're not saved, we're going astray. We might think we're okay. I mean, the way sheep go astray is they don't just usually bolt off, but they just kind of wander. And the way they're wandering is, you know, they wander a little bit and they look around, they can still hear the other bleating, and they can look and see other sheep and wander a little further and still see, hear the bleating and see other sheep and see a tuft of grass over there looks good. They go over there and still hear the bleating, a little faint, but I can still hear them and see them, and another tuft, and pretty soon, they may not even know where the rest of the flock is. They can't hear them, can't see them. They didn't lay down a path. They were just following where they wanted to go. And this is what happens when people are not aligned with God. They don't get into a congregation. They don't come under the authority of the church. They start to drift. It doesn't mean they don't believe in God. Well, the sheep still believe in the shepherd. They just don't know where he is. Those sheep still believe. If they hear his voice, they'll know it's him. They're just not in a place where they're allowing themselves to be protected and dealt and guided by the shepherd. Does that make sense? Okay, and so when we get saved, we come under the authority of the chief shepherd of our souls. The seven churches in Revelation had a chief shepherd. Again, sometimes you get people think, well, there's no such thing as a chief shepherd. It's just, you know, conglomeration. But it doesn't call it a shepherd, but he says to the angel of the church at Ephesus, to the angel of the church at Smyrna, to the angel at the church of Pergamos, of Thyatira, of Sardis, of Philadelphia, of Laodicea, to the angel. Well, it doesn't mean an angel, because why would God tell John, who's alive, to write things down, to give it back to an angel to take it to the church? Angel means messenger. And the pastor or the shepherd is the messenger to the sheep. So this shows us that in the early church, they definitely had a head shepherd or pastor. Does that make sense, what we're saying there? So you can go look at all of those scriptures if you want. So sheep need a shepherd. The Greek word for shepherd is poimen. Okay, it's also the same Greek word translated as pastors. So when we look over in Ephesians 4 and 11, it says he gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, or we could say shepherds, same Greek word that every other place in the New Testament is translated as shepherd, evangelist. So shepherds or pastors are an essential part of God's ministry in the body of Christ. Because again, sometimes you get some people say, well, it only says pastor one time in the New Testament. That's true, Ephesians 4 and 11. But the Greek word means shepherd. So if you want to say that, you know, he gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds, you know, and teachers, no problem, because it's the same idea. It means the same thing. Are you with me? So again, the word shepherds used many times. Jesus used the analogy. He had compassion because they looked like sheep without a shepherd, right? He looked out over the crowd a couple times. He said that. Amen. And he said he's the good shepherd, and he gave other examples. So terms pastor, bishop, and elder, they all have the same essential meaning of being a shepherd. So pastor, shepherd, the Greek is poimen. Bishop, Greek is episkopos or episkope, depending on the tense. Okay, a superintendent or chief. So a bishop is like a chief shepherd over other shepherds. Okay, elder, presbyteros. These are elders within the church. They still are involved in pastoring. They just might not have that official title, but they're still doing the pastoring aspects of the pastoring role within the church. Why is this important? Because we are sheep. We need God. We need to have guidance in our life. Amen. Okay, again, the analogy of sheep in a flock. Most sheep stay in the same flock for their whole life, don't they? Some ideas floating around about, you know, that, well, you know, you're only going to have a pastor for maybe part of your life. Well, that doesn't really fit the normal analogy of sheep, does it? And really, in real life with shepherds, if sheep change the flock, it's because the shepherds made a decision to do it. Right? You know, in real life, I got a shepherd here with a flock and a shepherd here with a flock. These sheep don't just decide we're going to that flock. The shepherd that owns them or is over them is going to have to decide, yeah, that's where they should go, and the other shepherd's going to have to agree. All right, so that doesn't mean that we don't ever change the congregation we're in, but it does mean you ought to be very careful about it because that's not the natural way. Does that make sense? All right, I hope you don't think I'm off too far in some place of Mars or something. Okay. So, Orion, at least it's in the Bible, you know. So, Venus is okay too. But sheep do not normally change. They're normally going to be, you're going to be where God puts you. All right, and if you're really following God, then the people over you are going to know something about where you're supposed to be, and where you think you're supposed to go, they're going to know something about it too, also. If God wants you out of congregation, he'll get you out even if nobody else wants you out. What human being can stop God? So if God doesn't really want you there, he'll get you out. All right? You don't have to fight your way off. You just have to be willing to listen to the Lord. Now, again, the devil knows sheep are defenseless. So he likes it when people aren't part of a flock, because he knows they don't really have any real natural defenses. So if he can get people isolated, he's got a good chance of getting them. So that's one of his big techniques, is to isolate a person from the congregation, get them offended so they won't talk and they feel animosity. And so then they don't come. And now the longer they don't come, the harder it is to come back, because they get all these ideas of what people might think while they were away. It doesn't even mean that the ideas are true. And people will make decisions not thinking about, what if I'm wrong and I have to come back over the bridge? But they emotionally burn the bridge, so it's difficult to come back. All right, so the devil likes to get people out of the church, isolate you, because he knows that when they're in the church, under the shepherd, or the shepherds, depending, you know, how big it is, and under the authority of the Lord, because really, the Lord is the true shepherd, and all pastors are under shepherds. We're just supposed to be trying to do what Jesus wants us to do. That's the idea. I'm supposed to be trying to do what Jesus wants us to do. Not what I want to do, what Jesus wants us to do. Amen? And he tries to destroy the pastor too, because as we read, smite the pastor, scatter the flock. So those are two of the big techniques that the enemy uses against the church. Isolate saints from the church, or try to destroy the pastor. Those are the two of the big techniques. And Jesus quoted that, Zechariah 13:7, on the night he was arrested. He says, as is written, smite the shepherd, scatter the flock. So I keep thinking of this story that I read, and I've told it here before. But back a few years ago, there's a man on the North Shore, or there was at the time. They had a herd of bison up there, kind of up near Newberry, port up near that area, okay, not too far from there. And he had a herd of bison, and what the wolves would do is they'd come out and try first to isolate one of the bison because they knew they couldn't deal with the bison in the herd. They couldn't deal with the bison if there's other ones around because they'll just mow them down. So they would try to get one isolated off. Once they got it isolated off, they drove it into the swamp. And once it's in the swamp, it gets stuck. And it can't get out. And then they would eventually attack it and take it down. So the reason that stuck with me is I said, that's what the devil does to people in the church. First isolates them. Then he drives you in the swamp of your mind and emotions till you can't think straight. You see, the house of God is a lot of times where we need to be to straighten out our thinking. Even when you got a prayer life and you're trying to follow the Lord, there's times where you need to come into the house of God, and all of a sudden when you come in, God starts to clarify everything. This is what's going on. It's going to be okay. Here's what you need to do. And he gives you scriptures and lifts up your spirit. And all of a sudden you realize, all that stuff, that's peripheral stuff. I don't even need to worry about it. Here's the issue. Here's what I need to do. Or God says, I'm taking care of it. And so church is of the utmost importance. It's important to be here when we can because it's a place where God does special things within the body of Christ. So again, the idea of a shepherd, shepherding God's people, it's a major concept within the whole Bible, the idea of shepherding and sheep. So Moses is a shepherd, right? And Joseph and his brothers were shepherds. David was a shepherd. And we read God's people are compared to a sheep, and they go astray when they don't have a shepherd. And many judgments in the prophets were judgments that God leveled against shepherds that were not really shepherding the flock the way they ought to be doing it. Okay, and so when Jesus says in Luke 19 and 10, I came to seek and to save that which is lost, he's really looking back at Ezekiel 34. Because God says, I'll come and be a shepherd, and I'll come to seek and save what was lost. So Jesus, in a way, was letting them know, I'm God, by saying that. All right, so he was trying to let them know that, but it kind of slipped by them, or at least most of them. Go look at that in Ezekiel 34 and 2, or 34 and 16. Ezekiel 34 and 16. Well, start at verse 11. For thus saith the Lord God, behold, I will both search out my sheep and seek them out as a shepherd seeketh out his flock in that day that he is among his sheep that are scattered. So will I seek out my sheep and deliver them out of all the places that they could have been scattered in the cloudy day. I will bring them out from the people, gather them from the countries, and will bring them to their own land and feed them upon the mountains of Israel by the rivers and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them in a good pasture, and upon the high mountains of Israel shall the fold be. There shall they lie in a good fold, and in a fat pasture shall they feed upon the mountains of Israel. I will feed my flock. I will cause them to lie down, saith the Lord God. I will seek that which was lost and bring it again. So Jesus was, through that, he was saying, I'm God. I'm the God that's going to be the shepherd. Amen. As we mentioned before, Jesus told Peter, feed my sheep, feed my lambs. The fivefold ministry, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, it's given by Jesus to the church to shepherd us, to build us up, So if we go back and we look at that Ephesians 4 and 11. Ephesians 4 and 11, he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, and we said pastors could also be shepherd, you could say that, for the perfecting of the saints. Okay, we need the ministry to perfect us. Okay, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry. We need the ministry to build us up so we can be involved in ministry. For the edifying of the body of Christ. Okay, we need to be perfected so that we can now add to the body, minister to the body. So God spends a lot of times in our lives trying to develop us so that at some point we become a part of the body, that we help minister to the body. Now, when we say that, that doesn't mean you have to have a formal position of pastor, Sunday school teacher, you know, greeter, elder. It doesn't mean that. There's all different kinds of ways that we can minister to each other. When you come to church and you sincerely worship God, God shows up where you are. If God shows up where you are, it's going to minister all the people that are around you. Amen. You come to worship God in sincerity and truth. That helps minister to the rest of the body. Amen. You come and pray for others. That helps minister to the rest of the body. So the ministry is there to help build us up so that we can help edify the body till we all come in the unity of the faith. So these offices, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastors, teachers, will exist until the church comes to the unity of faith. When's that going to happen? When the trumpet sounds. It's not going to happen before then. So what that means is the gifts are going to operate till Jesus comes back for the church. So anybody that says, oh, those have passed away, they're from the Old Testament, they're not looking at this verse. Because they're going to be there until we all come in the unity of faith. In other words, we're going to have to come to the same understanding of what God wants us to be and what the purpose of the church is. Amen? On to the knowledge of the Son of God, so it also has to do with our understanding of who Jesus is. And unto a perfect man, or a mature man, unto the measure of the stature of fullness of Christ. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine and sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive, but speaking the truth in love. So that's one thing, is we also need to learn how to speak the truth in love. That's the reason for coming to church. Amen. We might know the truth, but we might not know how to present it in love. Sometimes that's a hard lesson to learn. Sometimes we want to present the truth like John the Baptist preached. Bring forth fruits, meat for repentance. We're cutting down the tree. You know, there's a time to do that. But sometimes there's other ways that God wants us to do things. Amen? So we're all sheep. That's the role of being a Christian. Being a sheep means we need to get into the body, come under the authority of the chief shepherd, which means you come under the authority of the ministries that God puts you under so that we can grow and become the stature of the Lord, and we can also help edify the body and also learn to help the body grow. Can you say amen? Let's stand tonight. Amen. Lord God, we thank you for your word that's a lamp to our feet, light unto our path, Lord God. Help us understand that being a Christian, we've got multiple aspects, multiple roles or facets that are involved in our walk. Hallelujah. Lord, we're saints, but we're also sheep. Help us to learn how these different aspects work together, how we walk in these things so that we can be your people, your sheep, your saints, your church, we pray in Jesus' name. Everyone said amen. You're dismissed in the name of the Lord. God bless you. Shake hands with somebody. Say, I'm glad that you're here tonight. I'm glad you're here too. Good to see you.